In today's episode, I'm going to talk about expanding the storylines that you create in the first few sessions of running your Homebrewed campaign. Now, I'm doing this episode in response to a comment from a subscriber of my channel, MassMaverick1, who said that he'd seen quite a few videos on those first few sessions, but he wanted to know how to expand those storylines once you've gotten past the first few ideas that you've had for your campaign. This can seem like a daunting task, you know, just like world building is. But I've done this before, and not to worry, I got you covered. Hello again, I'm KR King, and this is my YouTube channel dedicated to homebrewing your own campaign. As I mentioned, this episode is about taking those storylines that you develop for the first few sessions of your campaign and building upon them and expanding on them and developing new storylines as your player characters make their way through the world. So the key here is to have a basic understanding of what makes a good story, how are they structured, and then what is the difference in story structure from, say, novels and films to the role-playing environment. So when we break down a story, we often ask, what makes today different than any other day? And this is usually called the initiating incident. You have a protagonist, the main character of your story, going through their normal world, and then something happens. Something happens that throws them out of their comfort zone and launches the story. When we break down stories, we often ask in terms of protagonists, what is the agent of change? What forces the protagonist to break away from their normal mode of life and learn something, achieve something, defend something, whatever? So you have the initiating incident that launches them, but typically this is either directed by or in relation to the antagonist. The antagonist of the story is the agent of change. So following this initiating incident, we have rising action, sort of the action of the story in which the protagonist struggles back and forth to try to finish their quest, try to get to the climax. And this is where typically the protagonist finally meets the antagonist and they have the final battle. And once that's resolved, we go back to normal, although it's a new normal because the protagonist has gone through changes, you know, based on the rising action and the climax. The antagonist has been an agent of change. So in Star Wars, for example, the initiating incident is Luke Skywalker getting the two droids. Because he's in his normal world, he's on this planet with his aunt and uncle, he buys these droids, and then he's launched on his quest to learn about the Force and to destroy the Death Star. Lord of the Rings, Frodo is launched into his story, the initiating incident, the Ring of Power, right? Bilbo leaves, he gets this ring, and he's launched on his quest to go to Mount Doom and destroy the ring. Notice the initiating incident, again, is almost always connected to the antagonist. You know, the droids lead to Darth Vader and the Death Star. The Ring of Power leads to Sauron and Mount Doom. We see the rising action in Star Wars as they make their way to the Death Star. We see this, of course, the quest, the Fellowship of the Ring in Lord of the Rings as Frodo and Sam make their way to Mount Doom. So in D&D, we do use the same basic story structure, but it's kind of turned on its head by the nature of role-playing. And when you understand how that differs from conventional storytelling, you have the key that unlocks the methods to create new storylines out of what the players are doing. So you as a GM create a world for your player characters to interact with, investigate, but it's basically frozen in time until the player characters interact with it. All these NPCs, all these things are just sitting there. They're waiting for them to go through the story. So in the storytelling world of Dungeons & Dragons, the player characters are the initiating incident. They are the ones that set things in motion. But there's something interesting here, because not only are the player characters the initiating incident of the story, but they're the protagonists of the story. They are Luke Skywalker. They are Frodo Baggins. They are the focus of the story, the reason that we are watching the story. But in terms of the game, what's interesting is what the players are doing. So they're initiating incidents in your world, but they are also the protagonist of your world. But it gets even more interesting. In terms of the story of your world, the player characters are the agent of change. They set things in motion, and then they affect things. They win battles or lose them. They have allies and enemies. They can cause armies to rise up, battles to occur, all sorts of changes in your world. So in this sense, the player characters are what sets the wheels in motion in your world. They are the initiating incident in each situation that they come across. They are the protagonists of the story that is being told in your world. And they are the antagonists of the story. They are the agent of change in your world. But it gets even more interesting. Because D&D is this interactive role-playing experience in which a story is being told as you play, the player characters are the audience as well. They are watching this unfold. They are discussing this offline. Why? Because they're real people in the real world. They don't just exist in this game environment. They are the initiating incident, they are the protagonist, they are the antagonist, and they are the viewer as well. Mind blown. This is what makes it an organic process. This is what makes it so dynamic and interesting and exciting, because the storytelling unfolds in a way that is unique to any other kind of stories that you might tell, whether you're watching something or reading something. You are involved as the player characters, and as the GM, you're reacting to that involvement in ways, you know, that then confront the player characters. So you've set up some stories at the beginning, but then it is the player's actions that should generate the follow-up storylines. In the world that I'm creating of Melanor, one of the storylines I'm going to have is there's going to be a group of orcs that are conducting guerrilla raids on villages near Dramos, my main town. And the player characters are going to confront this and probably defeat them. But what they're going to discover is there is a larger movement among orcs trying to unite different orcan tribes to drive the various so-called civilized races out of Melanor. When the players first do this, it depends on, you know, do they defeat them outright? Do several orcs escape? Do they follow those escaping orcs to a larger encampment? Is it too big for them to handle? So they have to get other people involved. Who's interested in this? Then you get the leading figures of Dramos or whatever. What do these guys know? And of course, your players are at the center of this, right? Because they defeated these orcs. And they know, have this knowledge of this, you know, larger group that's out there. When they defeat the orcs, where were they staying? Well, in turn, they were in an abandoned temple. Really? What's in this temple? They explore the temple. Maybe they have an encounter there. Maybe it's abandoned. Maybe there's nothing there. But wait, there's a mural on the wall. What is this? They look at this picture. It's sort of a, you know, St. George killing the dragon kind of thing, a martial thing, or it's a tapestry. And they either take the tapestry or they draw the picture. Now this picture comes to life. Why? Because they're going to take it back to town or whatever and try to investigate. And that's going to have a ripple effect, because now people in town who they ask about are aware of this. The temple is now empty. Nature abhors a vacuum, and so does the world of D&D. Something's going to happen. Something now is going to come to this temple, perhaps. Maybe the villagers try to seal it all up. Maybe the villagers go in and loot it or something and unleash something or whatever. Again, whatever storyline you want. So in my last episode, my sample starting session, I had the PCs be caravan guards, taking up 3 wagons of ale from the starting town of Dramos up to Maneth. And there was this rich family that didn't like this, so they sent these thug bandits to try to stop the PCs. The PCs defeat them, but they get to Maneth. First of all, the people that tried to stop them are surprised. What are they doing here? This guy Vesper, who was hired by the family to stop them, now he's embarrassed, he's failed, and he's going to react, because as a criminal, if someone goes against you and you don't do anything, there's no retribution, other people go, well, you're weak, right? So what is he going to do? If he doesn't attack them right there in Maneth, if he lets them get back to Dramos, maybe he sends guys down to spy on the player characters. Maybe these guys attack them in Dramos, or maybe they break into their room, try to figure out what's going on here. Maybe they spread rumors about the player characters, false rumors. Maybe they even go so far as to try to implicate them in a crime, right? They steal something from their room, and then they murder someone with it. All of these are borne out by the player's activities. They are antagonists to Vesper and the interests of the Ezrin clan. Now, the very advancement of your players in the world serves to generate new storylines. They'll attract more notice from the leading citizens of the world, also potentially monsters. The orcs now know about them if they're related to a larger tribe. You know, some villager may travel to another village and tell people about the great orc killers, and if they're being harassed by bandits or some other monster, they may approach your player characters and say, Would you help us? It's a great way for your player characters to get involved in something, discover new monsters, new situations, new secrets about the world. And it makes sense because they are agents of change. They did this and people start to know about them. Another thing to remember is the background information they've given you isn't just a static list. The people in their past also are launched into motion and also continue to live their lives. So what can happen is you can have someone from a player's past show up in town. It could be friend or foe. It's a way to get something in there that maybe they wouldn't have run into in their ordinary life, but it makes sense because they have a background and they are gaining in renown. They are becoming leading figures in your world as they advance. So for example, when the players go into a new city, the leader of that city may recognize one of your player characters because he knew their father, they were in the army together or they had adventures together, and he welcomes them. That can be very positive for the player characters, but it can be antagonizing to people around this leader who are jealous. Why is he paying so much attention to these guys, says the son, when he doesn't pay any attention to me, right? So it can be both good and bad. And don't forget about that audience relationship that your players have to the world. You don't like them to metagame too much, but they're still going to do it. They're still going to be aware that, oh, maybe I should go here, maybe I should go there. You know, what is this? If they do start to detect patterns that you have as a GM, it's always great to shake that up. You can actually use their expectations as an audience member to create an interesting twist to a plot, something they didn't expect. You can never truly get away from the fact that the players and yourself as a GM are an audience of this story that's being unveiled. So what you want to try to do is keep it in mind and not manipulate it too much, but know that if you throw something out there, the audience in them wants to investigate because they know it's a story and we want to find out. So this unique, dynamic, and organic relationship to the storytelling structure is how you can create these stories that interest the players. After the end of every session, think about what happened and think about the effects that your players' actions have on the world in general. What sort of initiating incidents can you think of in terms of their activities? How are they an antagonist? How are they an agent of change for the people in your world? And it should be fairly clear in terms of what they've done and who they've fought or whatever. You know, this can come from role-playing, in terms of when they go to different towns, who do they meet? It can come from the aftermath, the battles. Remember, even though the players leave it alone, what happens after the battle, at the site of that battle. When you know those things, and after every session, you think about the effect they've had in the world, the world has come to life everywhere they go, you can create storylines that are interesting, that are integrated into what the players are going, that make them feel part of the world. And also, it's creative for you, because you don't know which direction your players are going to go in. You give them stuff, you give them hints, but in a sandbox campaign, they go wherever they want. They force you to improvise. Improvisation can be easier when you're thinking in this way, because you think, well, wait, what are the connections here? What do the players know? Who have they affected? What have they done? And that's the key to creating storylines that your players will be interested in, and you'll have fun telling. So thanks so much for watching. Thanks for the comment, MazMaverick1. If you like what you've seen, I'd love to have more subscribers. Also, give me some comments. Give me some ideas that you have in terms of creating storylines. Your theories on story structure and how you do things for your players. I love to hear this kind of stuff because I want to get more information. In the meantime, keep playing D&D and tell somebody else about it.